There's a single word. It is the word Iran. When you say it today, there are all sorts of question marks. What in the world is going on? How could something like what has happened happening right this very minute happen? All those questions. I suppose if there's ever been a country we've seen totally change right before our eyes, it has been the government of Iran. What was it like? What's happening today? What's going to happen in the future? We have some guests with us today who are experts in this whole area. We'll talk about Iran, its future, what's taking place. So please stay with me. Glad you joined me today. I want you to meet three gentlemen. Admittedly, these men are on one side of the Iranian question, but it's important that we understand their side. You've heard a lot about the other side. Let's see what's going on from their perspective. I want you to meet Dr. Monishir Ganji. I'm glad you're with me, sir. He is the former Iranian Minister of Education and a special reporter of the United Nations and Economic and Social Development Commissions of Human Rights. I'm glad you're with me, sir.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you. And then Dr. Habib Monamez, am I right about that?
Monamez.
Professor of Political Science at National University, and he's the Secretary General of the United Movement of Iranian National Forces. And then I want you to meet Mr. Faradun Varishtah.
Thursday.
I'm close. Who's the former Iranian oil company representative for OPEC. I'm glad all three of you are here. Mm-hmm. May I ask you some very broad general questions to start, and then we'll get down to specifics. All of you, I suppose, oppose the Ayatollah. Am I right about that?
Quite right.
So I want you, people, I'm sure they will know right away where you stand anyway, but none of you are a part of his government or want to be associated with his government. Am I right about that? When you think about what's happening in Iran right this minute with all that's going on, are you mad? Are you disappointed? Are you resolved that this is what it's going to be? What are your feelings right now when you think of Iran?
Mad, disappointed, sad.
All the above.
Yes.
Can you believe that happened when you think about it, Dr. Ganji?
I still don't believe that it happened.
Who do you blame when you look back and you see the situation, you see the Ayatollah come in? Who do you blame for that?
It's easy to blame outside forces. I think partly we have to blame ourselves. And then certainly there were forces to whose interest it was to bring about the present chaos in Iran. Who is going to profit from the war between Iran and Iraq?
Who is going to?
The infrastructure of Iran and Iraq has been destroyed. Iran has lost at least $150 billion to $200 billion in way of industrial damage to its oil industry, dislocation, destruction of Abadan refinery. For years, Iran is going to be paying at least, take 10% interest rate of $200 billion. It's $20 billion. Mm-hmm. So Iran would have to pay for the rest of the time that it would have oil resources only in interest to buy what would be necessary to replace what Iran is losing.
I sense that what
now, therefore, who is going to benefit from it? Iran has a neighboring country to the north whose interest has been to bring about chaos.
Are you talking about the Soviet Union?
Certainly. Mm-hmm. And definitely the Soviet Union is going to...
Do you feel the Soviets brought Khomeini to power?
I don't really know who brought Khomeini to power, but I think the forces, if there were outside forces, which I'm certain there were, if Khomeini was aware of their existence or not, that's another question. But the forces that brought Khomeini to power could not be only Soviet Union, could not be only the Libyans, could not be only the Palestinians. There must be a variety of different kind of sources. Mind you, I am, for one, I think the Carter administration, the hodgepodge within that administration was such that they could not decide what they wanted to do and mm-hmm. how to help.
So do you blame Carter?
Unlike most of my compatriots outside who believe that the revolution was brought about by it was an American design, I don't necessarily think that it was an American design. Mm-hmm. I think the acts of omission, if not acts of commission. Mm-hmm. by the Carter administration helped very much to bring about this situation.
Do you think if Carter had been stronger, if he had been willing to do more militarily, do you think it would have ever taken place?
While we are discussing this, let me tell you this. Contrary again to what has been said and is being said outside of Iran, and contrary to what the Shah of Iran, former Shah of Iran, wrote in his memoirs, I, for one, believe that he was never a lackey of the United States, and that he was a patriot, and he had the interest of Iran deep in his heart. But unfortunately, towards the end, either it is his illness or it is his disappointment with what he sees happening in Iran, from what he has said himself in his book, in articles, he seems to have depended very much on the American administration. Mm-hmm. And he seems to have wanted some kind of moral support, not only moral support. Iran was buying all along, and is buying today, military supplies, industrial supplies from the West. Mm-hmm. Those days, this is quite obvious, and this has been reported in Senate hearings, the U.S. administration was refusing to provide the regime with riot control mm-hmm. methods which mm-hmm. are used in Western countries.
So do you see the United States should have moved in and done something even militarily to keep the Shah in power?
Not at all.
No?
U.S. didn't have to do that.
Uh-huh. You're saying that if they would have given them enough equipment, they could have done it themselves?
The Shah would have, you know, mm-hmm. again, if you read Mr. Jordan's memoirs, you will see that in one place after the death of the Shah, mm-hmm. Jordan and...
Hamilton Jordan.
Uh-huh. President Carter had been discussing in that morning. President Carter had said that the Shah of Iran, in spite of all the things said about him, didn't let the Savak and didn't let the military forces to turn against his own people in the last days. That was, in fact, mm-hmm. The characteristic of the Shah. Shah was not asking for military weapons to turn it against his own people. Mm-hmm. What I said, the riot control mechanism and technology, which mm-hmm. is applied in the United Kingdom.
Right.
In France,
right.
In this very country, those are the things which were not given to him.
But
that is the water hose, a very strong water hose. You pour it, you have seen it in the movie, in places. Mm-hmm. And you keep the people from getting close to a building and burning mm-hmm. a bank. Mm-hmm. Or going into a movie theater and putting movie to a theater on mm-hmm. fire.
Dr. Ganji, many people, though, feel that's the reason, the way the people were treated in Iran is the very reason the Shah finally lost his power, was because of the Savak and the police and the killings and the torture and all the stuff that he was doing to the people then.
I think you were, the night before last, Nightline had a report of how much misinformation and disinformation comes into play mm-hmm. in the media.
I saw that.
I think you all in this country and in Europe for 7, 8, 10 years, you played very well into the hands of those who wanted to make of the Shah of Iran a monster.
Are you saying...
And they made of him a monster to the point they did it so well that if you read a book written by Arnold de Borchgraf, the name of the book is Spike. This story, this part of the book, absolutely every American should consider what happened in it. Arnold de Borchgraf, the book talks about a Soviet KGB mm-hmm. Spy who defects to the United States, mm-hmm. and supposedly there is a Senate hearing. In the hearing, there is the fiction, the book is not fiction, all of it. There is a great deal of truth in the book. It talks about a revolution has taken place in Saudi Arabia. So in the Senate, they are asking this Soviet defector, how did KGB managed to bring about the revolution in Saudi Arabia. The man whose name in the book is Borosov. Borosov says, when the revolution in Saudi Arabia happened, I wasn't any longer in Soviet Union. At that time, I was in the United States. I had defected. But I am more or less certain we used the same tactics as we used in Iran, in Saudi Arabia. Then he says this. He says, for years, we managed, through the Western media, to make of the Shah of Iran the greatest monster, greatest savage, bloodthirsty ruler in the world, to the point that we ourselves did not have to move a finger, and we maintained the closest ties with Iran during all that time. Then he says, one point, he says, to show you how we manipulated the Western press. He says, when Shah left Iran, a recording of his voice was made in Soviet Union. And that recording was passed to East Germany, and through East Germany, through Iranian exiles, to Texas, to a group of Iranian Student Association in Texas. The Iranian Student Association in Texas hands it over to a local station, saying that this is authentic voice of the Shah. When he left the country, he has told his general, listen to it, to create, even to kill millions of people if necessary, bloodbath in all the streets, but bring me back. The voice, that in fact happened. That voice was passed by some people to stations, and that station gave, from that station, all other stations took it. For three consecutive days, they ran the voice. Fourth day, they came to examine and find out whether it was authentic. They came to the conclusion that it was a fake voice. That is fact. In the book, Borosov says, when we heard that they announced that this was a fake voice, we weren't concerned. The impact had already been done, and the public opinion was convinced that the Shah was a bloodthirsty animal. That is what was done, and I think, as far as the former regime of Iran is concerned, the story of Iran has not yet been told.
I'll give you a chance.
Unfortunately, he himself did not do much to open up and help.
Mm-hmm. I'll give you a chance to tell that story in just a minute. Stay there, please. As you can tell, if you've been watching, these gentlemen feel very deeply about what they're saying and feeling, and I want to make sure that you really understand where they're coming from, all right? So, lots of times we only listen to supposed experts instead of listening to people who are really living it out. Do you follow what I'm saying? We did a show the other day, and a person came to me after and said, listen, that person's written a book about it, but I lived it. And lots of times we want to listen to all the people who are telling us what supposedly is happening in Iran and places like that, instead of seeing the people that are being affected, their lives, their families, their country. And they're seeing these things happening in front of them. Dr. Habib, would you say, as Dr. Ganji said, was the Shah a much nicer man then than we have heard that he was?
Well, he certainly was, and he proved it, even during the time when the whole country was in uproar and he could have very easily crushed the opposition. He refused to do it. Mm-hmm. His generals came to him several times saying that, you know, just give us a few days and we will quiet the country down.
Why did he not do that?
Well, he didn't do it for several reasons. One, that he always had this conception of monarchy that a monarch should be different than a dictator, mm-hmm. although he was referred to all over the world as a dictator, mm-hmm. but he didn't want to be portrayed as someone like a president of a third world country or a dictator who wants to use any means in order to stay in power.
Do you think he underestimated the revolution?
He didn't underestimate the revolution, but he thought that these people were only asking for reforms in the beginning.
Yeah.
And all the reforms that they were asking, he was willing to do. In fact, he came into terms with one of the major opposition leaders, Dr. Shapur Bakhtiar, which he asked to become prime minister. He had been a leader of one of the major opposition groups for and had worked against the Shah for over 30 years.
Help me to understand, and all of you jump into this now. Help me to understand, what were they wanting? What changes were they talking about early on? I mean, before Khomeini came to power, when the riots would take place, and when the demonstrations even here in our own country would take place. What sort of changes were they wanting, so we could understand? And then how did it progress from that?
Well, in the beginning, they were asking for reforms. They were saying that they wanted constitutional monarchy, mm-hmm. and it was the Shah to only reign and not rule. Mm-hmm. And then after that, when the Shah started acting as a monarch, as somebody who is reigning and not ruling, mm-hmm. then the opposition saw a weakness in mm-hmm. this type of approach. Mm-hmm. And Khomeini, who had been in exile for several years, and who had a great deal of vengeance in him and had always been the champion of the more extreme fanatics of the clerics in Iran, saw this opportunity because the majority of the Iranian people are Muslims and they are Shiite Muslims, and he had been an Ayatollah, and Ayatollah is the top of the line as far as the hierarchy of the religion goes.
Right.
And so he had never held any position except being a religious figure.
Right.
So when he was talking about the fact that you know, the world was in so much trouble, and Iran was part of that world, and in the country we had so many problems, and the best way to solve all of these problems is to resort to religion, mm-hmm. and practice the ways of God. And then, I mean, nobody can argue against this.
Yeah, how do you argue that, right?
And nobody can argue against mm-hmm. this. And so what happened is that a lot of people in Iran were willing to give him the benefit of the doubt, because mm-hmm. he had said that he was not going to rule Iran. In fact, he was going to turn the government, after if they succeed, mm-hmm. to a group of people who were supposedly respected by the majority mm-hmm. of the people, in order mm-hmm. for them to rule and not him. But so what the methods that they used to come to power were the methods of deceit. Mm. What they did was to really...
Why is Khomeini... Why did they turn to Khomeini? What did they... what made him so powerful? Why was he in position?
Let me say, in any country which is fastly developing, like Iran, or even you can see signs of this in the more developed nations as well. You see that when the country is developing so much, there is progress. But with progress comes a lot of corruption, so the people start looking for the values in religion and mm-hmm. and so forth. You saw somebody in the United States like Reverend Jones was able to
Do you compare Khomeini to Jones?
I compare, in fact, the kinds of a Jonestown mentality that is now prevalent in Iran is exactly of what was happening when that Reverend Jones...
So you feel that there was just religion that got out of hand? Is that what you're saying?
No, it's not religion that got out of hand. You see, in order to understand this, you have to understand Iranian culture and how Islam was brought into Iran,
right.
and the difference with Arab culture. Islam was not the religion of the Iranian people. It was an Arab religion which was brought to Iran through conquest. Mm-hmm. So there was always an identity crisis. Mm-hmm. That's one of the reasons why Iranians are Shiite and the Arabs are mostly Sunni. Mm-hmm. Because the Iranians there was always this conflict, and with the people who had conquered them, mm-hmm. with the conquerors, they didn't want to, they wanted to also they remain Muslims, but not the kind of Muslims that those people were. Mm-hmm. They never took religion too seriously in Iran all these 1,400 years.
Yeah.
The values that, in fact, what Khomeini is preaching is very close to what the Shiites have been saying for a very long time. Not with the Quran or not the Islam, but the people were Muslims, but they were praying, many of them were praying five times a day, but they didn't know what they were praying. In other words, mm-hmm. the language of Islam is Arabic. And you have the Iranians who don't understand Arabic.
praying in Arabic.
Yeah. So a lot of the laws were as such, and because the religious people had never ruled the country. Well,
did the people want the strong Muslim thing which is happening there now with the dress code and all that?
No.
Did they realize all that was coming?
No, I think that there was a moral vacuum in the country, and the religious figures did a great deal during the time of turmoil to pretend as if they were going to fill that moral vacuum.
I think the causes of Iranian Revolution, they wouldn't call it revolution, whatever you call it, there was a revolution of rising expectations in Iran at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And what had brought the rising expectations was precisely what the regime was doing. Regime had made education free from kindergarten to the last year of university until you get your PhD.
Was he sharing the wealth?
When you open up the school doors, and overnight in 10 years we had 2.7 million children going to school.
Mm-hmm.
Towards the end we had 9 million children going to school in 10 years. In 10 years the country could not multiply the number of schools by four. I mean the construction, the square feet under construction, school buildings.
Mm-hmm.
Our teachers, we couldn't have possibly increased the number of teachers by four times in 10 years. Even if you, cannot order to a factory make you a teacher.
Sure.
You need a teacher to train a teacher. You need three teachers.
So how did that affect?
So naturally, when my child was going to school, because the education was free and the shortages of buildings, shortages of teacher, in certain places we had children going to school 3 days a week.
Mm-hmm.
In certain places, 5 days a week.
Mm-hmm.
The parent whose child was going to school only 2 or 3 days a week was dissatisfied. He or she wanted the child to go to school 6 days a week. But we were moving. We were trying to provide the 5 days and a half a week schooling for that child.
Mm-hmm.
But overnight you couldn't do it. These people, Khomeini promised before he came to Iran to give to every Iranian who didn't own a house, a house. That was promise number one. One house to every single Iranian immediately when he comes. He promised to make the electricity, the busing, the water services, all that utilities free of charge to the Iranians who couldn't afford to pay for it. There were so many promises being made.
Has he kept any of those?
Even opened, his supporters opened the places, butcheries called Islamic butcheries. They had chicken there, they were selling at lower price, meat at lower price. So populace was thinking, boy, what a deal we are going to have. This is a new deal. Mm-hmm. Let's move the bandwagon. And then the regime was not doing anything to really come out and communicate. One of the shortcomings of the Shah's regime was that we were also busy at the work of modernization and development of the country, that we lost sight of the necessity of communicating all that we were doing to the people and having the people at all times informed of what was happening.
I understand.
So they took advantage of all this.
I've got a break. There's much more. I want to get into all this. I'm understanding where you're coming from. I hope you are, so stay there. I'll be right back. All of you, I'm very glad you're with me today. And if I try to rush you through some of your answers, please forgive me. All right, I'm going to get to as many questions as I can, and to try to understand. You're saying things which, honestly, I've not heard. I want you to realize that, and I don't think a lot of American viewers have heard these things.
Yeah.
And so I want us to make sure we cover as much as we can. Thank you for being here today once again, Dr. Habib. May I ask you real quickly? Dr. Ganji, I guess you ought to take this. You're the minister, former minister of education.
Mm-hmm.
We saw in the States a bunch of students, Iranian students, who came to America, and they were demonstrating against the Shah here in America. They were wanting him out. Now, if things were so good at home, why were they demonstrating against him here in our own country?
Who says that things were so good at home? Everything is relative. If you are to compare the conditions in India today with conditions in France, things are not so good in India.
Mm-hmm.
If you are to compare the conditions in Nigeria or in Egypt with that in United Kingdom, the conditions are not so good.
Let me say this.
The youth which came to this country to study
Like were they myself. Comparing the United States
Absolutely.
To...
Absolutely. They wanted to have everything that they could find in New York as far as freedom of speech, assembly, association...
They didn't
right
want...
To, vote, to have it overnight in Iran in what kind of political culture? In a kind of political culture that freedom carries with it responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
You do not believe in the right to vote just because you want your one vote to determine who is the president. You believe in the right to vote because you believe it's better for the majority to elect a president rather than a minority to uphold power. That's a philosophy.
Right.
If you don't believe in that philosophy and you say, my right to vote, anyone I want to be president has to be president, everybody else has to shut up, then that is not philosophy of human rights and fundamental freedoms.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, in most of the less developed countries, you see that that philosophy does not prevail.
Did these students want the Ayatollah? Were they after the Ayatollah?
No, they wanted anyone.
No, they weren't after Ayatollah. They had most of the young people, of course.
Anyone but the Shah, is that what you're saying?
Anyone
but the Shah.
Well, most of the young people by nature are idealists and they want better society for themselves and for their people. And a lot of these people acted out of this feeling of idealism. They came to the United States, and when they come here and they see that this country is 200 years old and the situation is so much better,
and
Iran is 2,500 years and it has it's rich and it has oil and it has all that, then why can't we be like the people in the United States? Now, if you don't explain these things to them, I mean, you play with their emotions and you have the Palestinians and you have the Libyans with all of their money and you have all these leftist ideologues which play with these emotions, they finance them and they provoke them.
Are you saying you they were behind the students, these leftists?
Of course they were.
The
they
communists?
They were behind the students in the United States, they were behind the students in Europe. Mm-hmm. And during the revolution, we shouldn't forget, because Dr. Ganji touched on this a little bit earlier, but there was a lot of Libyan money. There was a lot of Syrian money.
Mm-hmm.
There was a lot of Palestinian activity. All of these through the KGB. All of these provoked by the KGB, financed by the KGB.
Are you saying that they were fomenting these kids all over the...
Let me give you examples. A lot of the Iranian leaders, a lot of the people who came to power, like Bodhzadeh, a name which you are familiar with, he was assassinated by the same regime a few days ago. Dr. Yazdi, who was their foreign minister, and you had a lot of others like this. They had all been, by their own admission, trained with the Palestinian guerrillas in Lebanon. They had most of them were carrying a Syrian passport, Libyan passports. These were the kinds of people who were behind all kinds of demonstrations that were taking place in the United States. So you're asking me if they were communist people behind them. They admit this themselves.
Mr. Verstappen, why didn't people, the businessmen, I mean, you were head of the Iranian oil company or the OPEC representative, why didn't you see what was happening and use that money that you guys were making? I mean, you were making billions of dollars. Why didn't you use that to do some of the things which needed to be done in that society to keep that society from breaking apart?
Well, one of the things that one of the plans that the Shah had, and he really emphasized, was the question of education.
Mm-hmm.
And if you consider that of the foreign students in the United States, the last years of the Shah, of all the foreign students from all countries, about half of them were Iranian.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. And when I was in the National Iranian Oil Company office in New York, we had a special department there that we were giving money every month to over 2,700 students. So this was one of the things that he was emphasizing.
Iran had 60,000 students outside at that time.
That he wanted to, he was of the opinion that the quickest and the best way
to educate them was to
move Iran forward, the image that he had of Iran, of the future, was the problem education.
Mm-hmm.
So he emphasized that. Now there was one point that I'd like to make over here, this is the question of Khomeini. A lot of people have a concept that he started this revolution and all that. Well, first of all, if one to sort of trying to dig in the history and trying to find out who this man is, you're talking about a man with a third grade education who's never read a newspaper in his life.
Absolutely.
If you, this Italian novelist asked him in an interview
that's the truth.
About, they were talking about music because no music is allowed in Iran, and she asked him, well, Mr. Khomeini, you feel all music are bad, and for example, people such as Mozart and Beethoven and all that, and he turned around and tells her that I never heard of these people. I don't know who they are, which is true.
Yes.
And if you read, I don't know whether you've read that trash that he's written,
yes,
so-called his theories and all that. You read it, and it's not only a comedy, but a tragedy at the same time. And this is the man who talks about sweat of a camel and or how to sodomize a chicken and that sort of thing. Mm. This is the garbage that he has, and this is what he preaches.
Mm.
When this movement started, the so-called revolution started, Khomeini was in Iraq, and until mid-1978, there was no talk of Khomeini. The whole business of Khomeini started when he came into Paris.
True.
So,
well, how did he get to that place?
If you want to say that this man started the revolution, he was the brain behind the revolution, how come there was no word of him?
Yeah, that's what I say. I mean, that's my question. Yeah, where did this guy come from? I mean, that is the question, I think.
I think we are looking at the history.
Uh-huh.
Let's look at realities today. Of what is happening? What has happened to Iran? Realities are very ugly.
Without a big, long, drawn-out scenario, which I know you could give, Dr. Gandhi, very easily, all right? Help me to compare. Compare Iran of the Shah,
I will.
Iran under the Ayatollah. Compare.
Iran under Shah and Iran under Ayatollah. Today, there are over 2 million Iranian professionals who have left Iran. They live in the United States, in Europe, and throughout the world.
Do they plan on going back?
They left Iran after Khomeini came to power.
Mm-hmm.
Most of these people had high hopes for Khomeini and had directly or indirectly supported the revolution. They have no intention of going back to Iran.
Mm.
These are the professionals the country has had. What my friend Feridun said is very important, Richard. The group which holds power in Iran, the average educational level, average of all of them is ninth grade. No, nothing above ninth grade. Ninth grade is too much to give them. Mm. The group that held power before Khomeini, ministerial level, 85% PhDs. From the best universities in this country, in Paris, in France, in United Kingdom, in Switzerland, in Belgium. With commitment to the institutions which had educated them, with commitment to human rights, to the dignity of individual human beings. But what kind of commitment these people have? The commitment is this. He says, anyone, this is New York Times, quotation from him, and this New York Times, May 28, 1981, yes,
mm-hmm.
page 5, quotation. Would you kindly read the quotation, what he says? He warned
that anyone intentionally ridiculing Iran's doctrine on Muslims would be considered an infidel. His property must be confiscated and he must be killed.
Anyone who ridicules the doctrine of Muslims, his wife is, he says his wife is what?
I don't see that part of it.
Yeah.
Anyway, that his property.
His marriage is null and void, he says. Above, it's a further above.
Mm-hmm.
His marriage is null and void. His property should be confiscated. His life should be taken. This is the kind of education these people have.
Mm.
Yes, one thing, Richard, over here.
Yes.
That has been a very important subject in this country for the last 4 or 5 years, and that is the question of human rights. I'm sure we all remember that what was written in newspapers and magazines in this country and Europe of the human rights abuses under the Shah and what Carter was emphasizing.
Right.
For some strange reason, in the last 4 years that Khomeini has come into power, nobody ever speaks of human rights in Iran in this country. You haven't found one American official who has ever said one word about human rights abuses in Iran. Why is that? Now, are you trying to tell me that there is no such thing as human right abuse in Iran? That's a joke. I mean, the torture, the imprisonment. My brother spent about 8 months in Khomeini's prison.
Are you afraid, speaking out like you are right now, are you afraid that you might be assassinated?
Afraid of what?
Of course I'm.
You afraid they
might
come
be assassinated,
you?
But we're not afraid.
Yeah.
I've got to break. I've got to break for just a minute. I want to come back. I want to talk about what you think is going to happen in the future. I mean, we all see every day. I've got your material here of people. How many thousands have been killed? 8,000, 9,000. Here's
amputation
the thing.
Amputation of arm and leg, stoning of a live human being to death.
How many pregnant women have they killed?
Who knows? Let's talk about what's going to happen when we get back. Can we do that? We'll take a break. Be right back. We'll talk about the future. So stay there.
When in the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex, make plans to join Richard in his studio audience. For more information, call area code 214-661-9930.
I'd say trying to understand this is very difficult. I guess you understand that it is difficult for us here in the West to see what's happening over there and know, you know, it's very difficult to sit in judgment on what's happening and not and know which side to land on. But I see some of the materials that you all have come up with, the National United Forces for the Liberation of Iran. And you've got this this thing in here about 30 teenage girls executed by Khomeini in one day. Now, why would there be 30 teenage girls executed in one day?
There is, in all the schools, they have supposedly purged the school, the educational system of the country, and there is reporting every day about children. Children report about their parents, the teacher, about the school administrator, they report against, about each other. If one of them utters a word against Khomeini, there have been many cases of the young girls being taken and executed in the presence of their mothers.
Why? I mean, what would they do
just
wrong?
Because they do not support any kind of expression of opinion, contrary to the expression of opinion, which he said, if anyone ridicules the doctrinaire clergy, his property will be confiscated and he should be killed. And he says anyone means anyone. 9-year-old, 7, we have had so many 9-year-olds executed. You see in Iran, left leg and right hand being cut, amputation of individuals' arm and leg as a punishment. You see public flogging continuously, everywhere you see public flogging taking place. Okay. They have destroyed, they have completely done away with all the laws, civil law, criminal law, criminal code of procedure, civil code of procedure, and they have replaced it by what was the facts of life 14th century ago in a tribe in a neighboring country of Iran that they want to emulate. And what does that code says? It says that eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth. If two persons are in a fight, somebody one breaks the teeth of the other one has the right to break the exactly the same tooth of this person. If somebody kills somebody, the relatives of the deceased have the right to kill the one who has killed the other individual. That is the law, that is the order which prevails in Iran.
Dr. Habib? But the most important reason for all of these executions is that the country is, the leadership in Iran is really scared. The great majority of the Iranian people have not realized that in fact these people came to power through deceit, everything that they promised them was not realized, and the preponderant majority is against them. They know that sooner or later they're going to be overthrown, and they want to prolong this. And the only way they can prolong this has been through these executions and through a reign of terror in order to crush any kind of.
What do you see in the future? I've only got. I want to be sure you get a chance to talk about this. What do you see happening in the future?
I think that there is no question that the Khomeini regime is going to go sooner or later, and.
Sooner or later, definitely, within the maximum, say, 2 years.
2 years?
Maximum.
What will happen? Do you see another uprising among the people, or what's going to take place?
I think the people have realized that they really were cheated, and that the country was marching towards progress, and they now are comparing what is happening in Iran now with what was happening before, and they have become more politically conscious. They look around themselves, they see other countries which are in the same area, and to what degree of development they have gone, and what are the really possibilities of that kind of a country with its resources.
Is the Shah's son going to come back to power?
No, I think that through all of these realizations, that there is a great that I think my this is a personal opinion that I think that the, that there will be a regime based on the principles of constitutional monarchy. Mm-hmm. The same things that the people in the beginning of that uprising were advocating.
Does that mean the Shah's son?
That means that the Shah's son, in fact, he mm-hmm. won't be a he will be a reigning monarch. But the country will be a democratic country, a majority.
Much like the United Kingdom today.
It will be mm-hmm. something like the United mm-hmm. Kingdom.
Do you agree with that?
Well, I, at any rate, I hope that if there is a change, it's going to be changed towards the new Shah. But there's one thing that we have to consider over here, mm-hmm. and that is in the last few years, especially because of the war between Iran and Iraq, and the weaponry that has been purchased from the Soviet Union, and you know, with the Russians, what they send in the weapons, the advisors follow. Mm-hmm. There's been an influx of Soviet advisors and technicians, and they have been spreading their web all over the country, and the infrastructure of the leftist movement and the Tudeh party has been quite strengthened.
So do you see a communist takeover?
It can happen if the West will sit on their hands. It can happen. There's no doubt about it.
What would you like to see? What would you like to see the United States do? What do you think our action toward toward Iran should be?
The only thing the United States should do is to certainly make it clear to the Soviets
to stay
hands off Iran. That's all the U.S. should do. We don't want the U.S. to do anything else. We'll do the rest ourselves.
We can take care of Khomeini
ourselves. All the U.S. would have to do, tell the Soviets, keep your hands off. And I think what will bring the downfall of Khomeini, as my friends have said, is the economic, in addition to all the ugly face of life, is the economic realities of life in Iran.
Do you
the price of a pound of meat, Richard, today in Iran is at least $8 to $9 if you can find
for
it.
For a pound?
A pound of meat. A pound of chicken in Iran is over $6 and $6.5 if you can find it again. One egg in Iran costs 50, 55 cents. One single egg, so forth and so on. And besides, the basic needs of the population, the regime is no longer able to provide, because most of these things they buy it from outside. Now they don't have the cash flow that they can buy these things and bring it from outside and give it, if they can give it cheap and without anything, without charge to the population. So economic condition tied with the casualties in Iran has suffered in the war with Iraq. Until the time that Iranian forces were fighting Iraqis in Iranian territory, Iranian people inside and outside were fully behind the war. But since the Iranian forces entered Iraq and the young children are being sent and tens of thousands of our young people are dying as a result of this mania, war mania efforts of Khomeini, certainly the population is no longer supporting him there.
I've got to break. I'll be back and let you finish. Okay. Stay there, please.
You know, it's the attitude at the top that makes a great team like the Cowboys. Now, I want to talk to you about another organization with a great attitude, Late Chevrolet in Richardson.
I really don't feel that we are the same, because I think our interest in customers, our sincerity that we approach a customer with, makes us a little bit different than the average retail organization today, because we do sincerely appreciate people and appreciate their dealing and their buying from us. And we try to let them know it and make them feel like that they are exactly what they are, and that's a very important part of Late Chevrolet. So I think this makes us a little bit different, yes, than the average organization.
That's why I'm driving this van from Late Chevrolet. It's their attitude that's built a great team. So now you can get on with building your great team.
There's there's a place on your face that skincare forgot. Excel marks the spot. Skincare comes to your lips in a totally new kind of lipstick. Excel has vitamins and emollients to moisturize, plus special ingredients to protect and heal, so lips look better, lips feel better.
Lips are better.
Excel by Quencher, in 20 deep caring colors, for the place on your face that skincare forgot. Excel marks the spot.
People are talking about TV 39 Star Trek.
I like it, because I like Mr. Spock.
Tonight on Star Trek. Talking about Star Trek tonight at 10:30 on TV 39.
39 takes a lot of time in choosing your programming.
We may come over there a little bit later, right? Dr. Abib, you were about to say something a while ago, and I want to be sure you
get to say it.
Yes.
I was going to say that you asked me a question about what I think will be the course of the future. Mm-hmm. And I said that I think that it's going to be based on the principles of constitutional monarchy. And the late Shah's son, Reza Shah II, will be the reigning monarch. Now, there is a lot of things being said these days about the Mujahideen. And these are the people who were mainly responsible for bringing Khomeini to power. And there was a power struggle, and when they were kicked out, they came opposing Khomeini, and now they are doing it very heroically. In fact, a lot of the people who are now being executed belong to the Mujahideen group. Mm-hmm. The reason why the Mujahideen cannot succeed is because they do not have the support of the of any organized faction of the Iranian population. In other words, the people in the villages don't support them, the technocrats don't support them, the laborers don't support them, the army doesn't support them, and they don't have any support within the tribes. Because mostly the Iranian people hold them, as well as Khomeini, responsible for what happened in Iran. So they have the courage and the bravery to fight the regime, but because they don't have the support of the Iranian people, they're not going to succeed. Mm-hmm. The people who are going to succeed are going to be the people who will have the support of the Iranian people.
Heroism is admired by all Iranians, mm-hmm. of all mm-hmm. shades of opinion.
Is there an organization that's working to bring the Shah, bring the Shah's son back to power? I mean, is that happening?
Yes.
Are you all raising money? Is something like that taking place?
There are many different organizations which are working within Iran and outside of Iran. Outside of Iran, they are mostly managed by the technocrats, mm-hmm. who have now found out that in fact what has become of the country that they worked for so hard and they were responsible
and they
for
wanted
25.
To see it back
and they want to
I understand. Gentlemen, I must thank all of you for being here today. Thank you very much. You have said things which frankly I've never heard before, and I appreciate you being here and sharing with us.
Thank you for
thank
having
you,
me
you bet.
For
thank you and I'll see you tomorrow. Bye bye.
Stay tuned for Midday Edition News coming up next.